Okay, hello everybody. Thank you, Silvia, for the introduction. Now I will show you the preliminary results of the application of the biofeedback protocol. I work in Centro Medico Sant'Agostino, which is a private clinic here in Milano, which has decided to try to put into the ground this new way of performing biofeedback. So. Okay, let's start with a short definition of biofeedback. Probably most of all already know something about biofeedback. Biofeedback is a mind-body technique in which individuals gain information regarding a physiological function in order to improve the perception of control over it. I would add also the awareness of it, and then the goal is to improve the perception of control. So the aim of biofeedback is getting in touch the subject or the patient with its physiological activation in order to improve the knowledge about it. For example, what we use in this protocol is breath rate and heart rate to treat anxiety disorders, hypertension, and other psychosomatic symptoms. This means that the subject, the patient, will have a look in real time at these psychophysiological signals in order to try to control it. Let's see how we can do it. Biofeedback is, we can divide the words in bio and feedback. So bio is what we need to real time get from the patient. We in the slide, there is the device we use, which is a Zephyr belt, chest belt with all the specific written down it, that the subject wears, and via Bluetooth the signals are directly sent to the laptop. So this is how we collect the signal. The second phase is how to show the signal to the patient, and this is the new ways of show the signal to patient, which is the virtual reality feedback, which is using a virtual scenario like the one represented in the slide, which is a flame, knowing that the size of the flame depends on the parameter that we have selected. For example, if we select breath rate, the flame will be higher, will be bigger, if the subject is breathing stronger. Whereas if the subject is breathing lower, the fire will be lower. And so this is also for the heart rate. Virtual reality. We have already heard many things about virtual reality, so I will not repeat all the things about the presence and so on. Just to think back of the way in which virtual reality can be an added value for biofeedback. At first, we have to say that virtual reality has proven its efficacy as an effective medium, so the interaction with virtual reality not only enhances the sense of presence in the world or in the scenario we are looking at, but also the mood of the scenario gets linked with the mood of the people who is experiencing it. As we already saw, for example, before with social phobia, if we use a stressful environment, we send stress to the people experiencing the virtual scenario. Whereas if we use a relaxing scenario, like the one we saw before, a campfire, the mood of the subject will be also set to a relaxing way. And the second added value of virtual reality in using biofeedback is the way of the feedback. So the feedback is not given through a pattern, through a graphical pattern that goes up and down, but with the outcome of the pattern, which can be high or low, like the flame I showed you before. This is what I have just said. With the virtual reality biofeedback, I think that we can give the feedback on the effectiveness of the technique the subject is using. For example, a patient is trying to reduce its arousal in a wrong way, the flame shows a negative outcome with the flame getting higher. Whereas if you use a traditional biofeedback, there is the feedback is more, in my opinion, related to the accuracy of the pattern. That is, we trying to force it to breathe in the correct way, so that the subject learns how to perform the breathing, like we see in the slide. There is the people is forced to move and to breathe following the blue line. So, how do we apply the short biofeedback protocol? We start from a preliminary meeting. In the preliminary meeting, we introduce biofeedback to the subject. We explain what biofeedback is, the importance of real-time feedback, and its possibility to stimulate the learning of a better pattern to manage the arousal. We collect a short medical history, an analysis, and then we start with an assessment of a personal breathing pattern. This is the only way, the only moment, and we try to force something to the subject. We use a pacer. The pacer is a tool that tries to identify the relaxation breathing pattern of the people. For example, to the subject is asked to follow the green ball, inspiring and expiring during the task, and then we try to identify the real relaxing pattern of the subject. This is the only traditional biofeedback technique we use, but because after this, in the following four biofeedback sessions, the subject is asked to try to perform a relaxation breathing, but it's not forced to follow a specific way to breathe. It said, okay, we have assessed your relaxation breathing, now try use it, try to modify it, and check what the outcome is following the size of the flame. So we try to develop a short protocol, because literature shows the efficacy of biofeedback mainly in 8 to 10 sessions. We try to identify a faster way to gain benefits in scheduling 4 sessions. The first session is related to breath rate. So the patient is told to try to decrease the size of the virtual fire only by knowing that the working of the breath pattern is the key to change it. We do not focus on how the subject has to decrease the flame. Just try your spontaneous activities and see what they can do on your state of arousal. And this is the first session, so a direct impact with the biofeedback that allows the patient to identify the efficacy of the technique he or she already has. In the second session, there is a small training, so it's a further step that allows to give the patient a specific issue related to relaxed breathing, for example, adding some techniques. And the goal of this session is to identify whether using this technique, whether the changes we suggested have been effective in modifying the fire. So the session are all structured in the same way. At the beginning, there is the technological setting is set, and then the feedback session last 15 minutes. So, for example, in the first session, the subject tries for 15 minutes to reduce the size of the flame with the personal spontaneous techniques he or she already has. Whereas in the second session, the subject tries to perform the advices what we have already talked before the session to reduce the size of the flame. So at the end of this 2 brief rate session of biofeedback, the subject has a comparison between the level he has before and the outcome of the fire of the campfire he or she succeeded to achieve compared to the second one, so he can notice immediately if the technique he has is training are effective or not to reduce the size of the campfire and so to reduce the, its arousal. Third and third session follow the same pattern, because in the first session we move to heart rate. So we try to, and we tell the subject that now the size of the fire is gets related to the heart rate. So it's not related to the breath patterns, but to the heart rate. The situation is the same, but the, of course, the technique applied and learned about the breath patterns will not be so effective on heart rate because it's a different psychophysiological signal. So no specific hints are given also in this session, just to let the subject know if other techniques are effective to reduce the flame. These techniques can be the breathing techniques already applied or other techniques that the subject tries to perform in order to reduce the size of the flame. It's important in this third session, as it was also important in the first session, that the first step is the awareness, because the subject gets in touch with the specific pattern of the signal. The subject is also an important teaching for the subject to identify that the trend of these two signals, breath rate and heart rate, are very different from each other. So in order to try to manage also them in different ways. For example, in the first, in the fourth, and the last, in the last session, there will be explained some muscular relaxation techniques, which are for example, also about postures, to teach further possible ways to control the arousal. So, like it was done in the second session, we gave some advice. And having a biofeedback session with the flame, the subject gets back the effectiveness of the technique, trying to identify if they are effective or not. Okay, this is the protocol, what we try to apply. And we have also administered some questionnaire to identify whether the short protocol, which is kind of innovative, or not only for the virtual reality, but also for the short time of session required, is effective or not. And this study is preliminary because the sample is quite small. There are 11 people. These people were subject suffering from medical conditions like anxiety disorder or somatic symptoms or small form of hypertension. That are all clinical conditions related to difficulties in managing the personal arousal. Okay, so the questionnaire were mainly three: the STAI state, which is the questionnaire to assess the level of anxiety in the moment, the Toronto Alexithymia scale, and an anxiety sensitivity index. And the questionnaire were administered to the subject via mail after the preliminary meeting and the end of the fifth meeting, so after 4 weeks, because each meeting was one a week. Okay, here are the results. The results show a significant decrease both in state anxiety and in anxiety sensitivity, because I think my opinion is that the management of the anxious state during the biofeedback session is encouraged by the specific request to reduce the size of the flame, which is different compared to the traditional biofeedback that does not offer a direct outcome of the modification acquired. Okay, to conclude, this kind of training allows the patient in improve the skills, like I have already stressed, and the real-time biofeedback allows the management of physiological variation. And the first step is surely represented by the awareness of the way the parameter swings. For example, the breath signals swings more than the heart rate. The variability is stronger, and the subject can perceive it. The sensitivity to anxiety may decrease because biofeedback teaches the subject that the sudden increase is neither extraordinary or overwhelming. This is very important for people suffering of anxiety disorder, because they have to face an arousal that sounds very scary to them. And so having the opportunity to see the outcome of the technique, let them know that this arousal is not overwhelming, neither extraordinary. Okay, to conclude the limitation and future result, of course, I have spoken about virtuality biofeedback and traditional biofeedback, but there is still not evidence about which one is better. I don't think one is better than the other. I think they have different purposes and they are suitable for different subjects. I think some kind of people may appreciate more the use of traditional biofeedback, and for some other it might be more useful to use a virtuality biofeedback. Okay, and to conclude is also to check the use of virtual reality, if it is a barrier or not, because we have 6 out of 21 dropout, but we don't know if it was due to barriers using virtual reality or to the barrier using biofeedback, which is a technique that is not also well perceived from many people. Okay, thank you.